The Saturn V rocket took humans to the moon for the first time, but the humans didn't steer the rocket. It steered itself using a computer.
Tower cleared.
We got a roll program.
A lot of the Saturn V rocket was built here in Huntsville, Alabama, otherwise known as Rocket City. And one of the really cool things about living here is it's filled with aerospace and computer engineers who love this stuff. So a thing you can actually do here is pick up the phone and call one of your friends and have them call their friend. And before you know it, you're in a parking lot receiving a Saturn V memory module from a guy you just met, and he just trusts that you're gonna give it back to him. This is 14 kilobytes of data, which is really interesting because the same day I got this, I had Linus Sebastian from Linus Tech Tips here. We were installing a server that was over 100 terabytes. Now, millions of people look to Linus to understand more about modern computing hardware, so I thought a really cool thing to do would be stop what we were doing with the server and take a closer look at this memory module and how it works. Let's sit back and watch a modern computer nerd learn about the cutting-edge technology from the 1960s. I'm Destin. Let's go get smarter every day.
Have you ever seen a Saturn V rocket?
No.
Okay, do you know what the Saturn V is?
Yes.
My daily life literally revolves around the Saturn V. Like that's the Saturn V peeking out over the trees right there.
Oh, there it is. Hello.
In the 60s, they had just started building digital computers, and I'm gonna show you the computer that they used to steer that thing.
I mean, it's gotta be a bit of a terrifying experience having like, you know, the equivalent of a very large bomb strapped to your butt.
So this is the brain for the Saturn V rocket. If you look up right here, this is the instrumentation ring. And so they had computers on here that were digital. This right here is the launch vehicle digital computer. That is it. This right here is a memory module, okay? And if you look really, really, really close, you see those little bitty rings?
Yeah.
Okay, look right here. Look at that. Do you see that?
Holy smokes. So they're just, it looks like zip ties on chicken wire.
Okay, those are bits. Those are physical bits. So you see that screen?
Yeah.
These are wires that go down to these boards right here, right?
Yeah.
On each node, you have an iron ring. And depending on how the iron ring is magnetized, that's a one or a zero. That's how they programmed this computer. Seriously. So look at this right here.
So by hand.
By hand, yes.
They threaded these wires through the... I mean, who has a steady in it? Like, I don't even think you could build one of these today if you wanted to. That's incredible.
So there's a guy that worked on this in the 60s here. His name is Luke.
Yeah.
And you get to ask him all of these questions.
Fantastic.
I'm Luke Talley, and at this time in 1969, I was a senior associate engineer at IBM in Huntsville.
So your computer pointed the rocket?
That's right.
Awesome.
We steered the rocket. That's a memory module.
It's a whole memory module, yeah.
You must have shot somebody to get that.
So how valuable would you say
this,
that is?
I have no idea. You have to go to the antique roadshow. This computer controls all the timing, start engine, stop engine, fire separation rockets, fire retro rockets, all this kind of stuff. It does navigation and guidance. You have stored in the memory a profile. At this point in time, I need to be here, going this fast, going in this direction. Now realize that this is core memory. So you have these magnetic cores, you have the wires feeding through the cores. You push a current down through a wire. All right, if you got a wire, if current's going in that direction, the magnetic field is going to be in this direction. If it's going this way, it'll be that way.
Yeah.
Make that a one, make that a zero. There's 8,192 of those on this plane, all right?
Yeah.
Then there's 14 of those planes stack up to make this module. This module is what you're holding. All this stuff now are the drivers to drive this
thing.
That's
just to program it as a one or a zero.
Because this is basically an analog process.
Right.
I'm not writing ones and zeros into a logic gate and storing them that way.
No, you're just
I'm actually having to magnetize a core one way or the other. And then I've got to read it. And when I read it, I destroy the magnetization. So I have to turn right back around and write it back in there so that it's not missing.
Oh, right? No.
So there's one of these in this. And then there's one of these now in each one of these blocks on this wall over here.
Got it.
So we have 4, 8, 12, 16,000 words of memory. Another 4, 8, 12, 16,000 words of memory. Now, when the Saturn's flying, both of these memories are executing the same flight program.
Completely in parallel.
That's right. And they're comparing the outputs to make sure they're getting the same answer. If they were to not get the same answer, if going to subroutine and say, I'm at this point in the flight, I got these two numbers, what makes the most sense to keep using, use that number and keep going. Your critical parts are triple redundant in the logic, dual redundant in the memory. As I recall, during all the Saturn flights, we had like less than 10 miscompares, something like that. It was a very small number.
When you're building a rocket, you have some important parameters that you have to monitor. Power, data bandwidth, mass, volume. You have to manage these so they don't get out of control. So you want a reliable system, but at some point you have to make a decision. How redundant is redundant enough?
Unreliability. That's the key. Because the more of these things, more cores you add, the more of this stuff you need, the more unreliability you add to your system because sheer numbers of parts.
Right.
Luke is about to explain what it was like to receive data from the Saturn V via telemetry and then analyze it. And I'm going to let this play out because I want you to understand how repetitive and difficult this task was. Today we could do this with just a few minutes and some spreadsheet software, but back in the day, they were the computers, like the people were the computers. So I want you to see it through his eyes, through this historical lens, so you understand what it was like to analyze the Saturn V data.
So did you pull the data down while it was flying?
Things happen too quick in flight too.
How do you know you had?
We get the data back and then we analyze. That was my job at IBM, is we were analyzing the flight data to determine what worked, what didn't work. If it didn't work on this flight, how do we fix it on the next flight?
Got it.
And then when you get the NASA requirements for the next flight, make sure we got everything in place to do what we are supposed to do. So the data tapes come from all around the world through Goddard Space Flight Center, is responsible for that. So they get us the data and then we analyze it and determine what happened. Something would go wrong in the computer, and it always goes wrong when something else is messing up the telemetry system. So we would actually get what they call an octal dump. We have this 11 by 17 sheet of paper, 10-bit octal numbers, so you'd have, there were four characters, like 0 to 7, so as you go with octal arithmetic. So you got all these things, and I think it was like maybe 40 columns and 30 rows, something like that. So we would get this thing printed out, and all it's just numbers. Well, the piece we're looking for is at a particular place down here. Well, the dropout is where we, you know, telemetry dropout. So we would actually get this printed out, 11 by 7 fan fold paper, spread it down the hallway, get down on your hands and knees, make a template, cut out the, you'll have a number of measurements that'll always be the same, you know,
right,
like a voltage that never changes.
Yeah.
So we know what those numbers ought to be. So we cut the holes out and slide it down page by page. Oh, hey, these all look good. Okay, this frame's probably good. So we go find so many columns, so many rows, find the number we want, write it down.
So you're looking for one that if it bungs up something that you know is a fixed value, then it probably bunged up something else.
That's right. And if the fixed value is okay, then somewhere in there, our number is probably okay.
And then once you've got the problematic one, I mean, is that just the world's nastiest Sudoku puzzle, or how do you solve that?
You may have to do this for many, many, many frames. Then you take it to your desk and take those octal numbers, convert them to decimal numbers, go to a calibration chart, and say, okay, I got this number.
Yeah.
Go up my chart and say, that means it's 5 degrees centigrade. So you write down 5 degrees, and you figure out what frame you are. That's about what time it is. So at this time, I had 5 degrees. Then you go to the next one. Now you do this for about 2 weeks, and finally you got enough to plot a graph by hand. So you put all these numbers in, and you plot it by hand, and then you say, that wasn't the problem after all. Oh, well, here we go again. So,
oh boy.
This is Ed.
Hi.
Ed is the head curator.
Hey, Linus, how are you? This is kind of an in-the-hand example of the memory cores that you can see woven into the spread here and then kind of under the magnification over here. And there's about 8 or 9 of them in there. So like Luke was saying, when you run the current through there, it starts to spin that donut in a particular direction, and that tells you whether it's the 1 or the 0. And you're saying they were woven on by hand. It was primarily women that did the work, that had basically a bench top.
So they would have like textile industry experience, I guess.
I actually am not certain what their qualifications were, but they would sit with a bench top with this thing mounted in a holder with copper wire lengths and tweezers and their fingers and a a lot more patience than I have to weed these things through there to make sure that they went through appropriately, no kinks, no bends that were out of a spec, and to actually make sure that the little donuts go into across, you know, the way they should, and that was all uniform, so everything would be predictable behavior.
Incredible. So
I just wanted you to hold a physical bit. Now you know what that's like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, this is more than 8 bits, so this is, I'm holding at least a bite. Think about it that way.
So when you look at this, what kind of emotion do you feel when you look at this, Luke? Are you
is
proud?
Is it fondness, or is it more just, thank goodness I don't have to work on that bloody thing anymore?
No, I'm going to talk to one of my buddies when you go out the building here and get you in the head.
To get this thing?
Yeah. No, that's a real piece of work, you know, and it looks, to people that come in here, they say this just looks so much like an antique. But again, we only had a few failures during the whole flight that were intermittent. We never had a catastrophic failure.
People might say antique, but I would say handcrafted.
Yes, there's a lot of handwork went into these.
Oh, you can tell. I mean, even these are, they're clearly hand-bent.
Well, they've got the goop on them, because the big problem with this thing is vibration. The memory that we were looking at over there.
Yeah, you've got physical rings on there.
They test and test and test on that thing to make sure that you hadn't got a kink in a wire or a twist, because if you do, the vibration is going to cause it to break. Those things were made by hand. The ladies actually wove these things like you're weaving a piece of cloth. Pretty amazing.
Oh, this is fascinating. Thank you very much, by the way.
I want to say thanks to the sponsor today, which is Audible. I'm about to recommend a 13-hour audiobook about salt, and you're going to think I'm crazy, but I'm not, because it's amazing. This is a book called Salt, A World History by Mark Kurlansky, and it is amazing. Like, everything from Natron in the Egyptian desert to why Civil War battles were fought the way they were because there were certain salt works in certain locations, to why Gandhi walked to the ocean. And it also tells you about, like, garum, which is a Roman sauce that was like Roman ketchup that we don't even know how to make anymore. This audiobook is amazing, and you should listen to it. You can get it by going to audible.com/smarter or texting the word smarter to 500-500. I know it would make more sense to, like, recommend an audiobook about space, but this is what I'm actually listening to, and it's incredible. So audible.com/smarter or text the word smarter to 500-500. Get your first audiobook for free, plus 2 free Audible originals when you try Audible for 30 days by using these links, audible.com/smarter. You will love this book. Please do that. That supports Smarter every day. When you support Smarter every day, it lets me do more videos about the stuff I love. If you want to see more of this interaction between Linus and Luke, it's incredible. Like, on the second channel, there's a 30-minute video of Luke going all the way down the rabbit hole. This guy knows his stuff. Like, I feel like I know rockets pretty well. Linus certainly knows computers, but when we're sitting there, it's almost like Luke could just run around both of us. Go check that out on the second channel. Also, go check out Linus's channel. I'll just let Linus do an outro himself.
Go check out Linus's channel, Linus Tech Tips. He's talking about, what's it called again?
The instrument unit. Basically, we talk a little bit about the computer, but Destin's got a little more information on that. But I really love the cooling system on this thing. It's gonna blow your guys' mind. Unreal.
Yeah, it's awesome. So it's at the top of the rocket, because as you've got all three stages of the Saturn V, you need your instrument unit way up here so you can guide the Saturn V before the Apollo computer takes over. But Linus talks about details of power and how that stuff works. It's pretty cool. Yeah. Thanks, dude. Appreciate
it. Guys.
Thank you. Thanks, guys. Yeah. Thank you.
It's called Space Camp.
Space Camp.
Yeah.
So all those kids are here to learn how to be astronauts and fighter pilots.
That's Luke.
No.
That's Luke. Yeah.
No way.
Yeah.
On the left there, apparently.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, huh?
Luke Talley. There it is. Far left. That's nuts.
It's pretty neat, isn't it?